I'm Amanda Clark, president of the Seattle King County League of Women Voters. And actually, before we get started, Carolyn Hale would like to make an announcement.
Welcome, all of you. Let me see a smile. I always want to see a smile. I'm a clown, right? You can't hear me? That's better. Thank you. I'm here to say two things. One, the Circle of Friends for Mental Health, who works for adults with serious mental illness and teens with addiction, is going to have a charity golf tournament on September 24th at Jefferson. If you know any golfers, you can send them along. We're also going to have our art event where we show the art, the drama, all the things that Circle of Friends classes do. And you're welcome to come to dinner and do that. And you can see us called Friends for Mental Health. The second thing is, I would like everyone to pick up a copy of The Stranger this week and read the article on housing. It's the answer we need, definitely, for mental health in this and homelessness in the state of Washington. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming out this evening to what I hope is a very interesting and thought-provoking forum with three different bond issues or levies that are on the ballot right now. One in all of King County, which is the Best Starts for Kids, and two on the Seattle ballot, the transportation levy and the Honest Elections Seattle levy, Initiative 122. I'd also like to say that September is Voter Registration Month. I'm assuming that everyone here is registered, but if you know someone, say a young person, you know, that will be 18 by Voters Day, please encourage them to register, or if somebody, you know somebody who's moved, they have to re-register. So, anyway, and I would like to now introduce to you our moderator for the evening, Ellen Barton, who's the immediate past president of the League, and she will explain kind of the rules of the evening, you know, the timing, and what's going on. So. I'm gonna go
out this way. Yeah, we have some cords up here that we might trip over later. If the first three speakers could please come up and take your seats. Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I want to offer a great thank you to all our volunteers this evening that helped make this happen, with a special thanks to our friends at the Seattle Channel and King County TV. Both are here tonight. We're filming this tonight for future cablecast and webcast. Just a reminder, the League of Women Voters retains copyrights to a filmed copy of the content of our program tonight. It will be rebroadcast on the Seattle Channel and apparently King County TV and streamed on their websites and our website on demand. We do encourage links to the whole broadcast, but please do not take small portions of it out of context to make it look like someone's saying something different than what they really were saying. Okay, so now let me take a moment to briefly go over the rules of engagement for this evening. The League believes that good people can disagree without being disagreeable, and so we structure our forums so that we can have those kinds of conversations. Each of the measures we are discussing will be allowed, for each of the measures we're discussing, the proponent and the con side will be allowed 2 minutes to make an introduction. They're gonna give us their best elevator speech. An elevator speech is that impassioned speech you make in politics to promote your cause or candidate, and it lasts just for the duration of the elevator ride. Our lovely timekeeper, Julianne Kempf, will give you a signal when you are down to just 30 seconds, and then again when you're down to 10 seconds. And also will, of course, signal when it's time to stop talking. And when it's time, it's time. We have a tight schedule tonight, and I'm sure everybody wants to get their questions answered. So I'll let you finish a sentence that you've started, but please don't go on and overrun the timer. And about the questions, when we enter the question and answer portion of the meeting, we'll start with a few league-developed questions. Then we'll take our questions from the audience, and there are cards on the... Everybody knows the drill, I think, but there are cards. Yeah, do we have ushers? Who is going to be picking up? Yes, we do, right here. So wave it when you have a question, and she'll come and pick those up. And for each question, I'll tell you how much time you will have, because it varies depending, I think, on how complicated the question is. We will not read any of the following questions. No ad hominem attacks or questions, meaning no questions pointed to a specific individual and no statements of support or opposition without a question attached. Any questions must be germane to the topic at hand, which provide an opportunity for each side to argue for their position. The questions must relate to the scope of the ballot issue we are discussing. For example, questions about the presidential debates are not useful when discussing a local transportation funding measure. Although interesting, perhaps not germane. Okay, so here we go. We'll begin with the King County Proposition 1, Best Starts for Kids. On the con side, we have George Scott. And on the pro side, we have Mike, is it Heinisch? And Sheila Capistani, and they will, so please give them a warm welcome. And I'm just gonna give you a brief summary of the initiative. Best Starts for Kids is an initiative with a goal to improve the health and well-being of King County children. With a goal of investing in prevention and early intervention for children, youth, families, and communities. The King County Council has voted to put the levy on the ballot to fund the initiative. The levy rate is 14 cents per 1,000 of assessed property value, which would raise roughly $65 million per year. 50% of the revenue would be invested in strategies focused on children under age 5 and pregnant women. 35% of the revenue would be invested in strategies focusing on children and youth aged 5 through 24. 10% of the revenue would be invested in strategies to create safe and healthy communities. 5% would support evaluation, data collection, and improving the delivery of services and programs for children and youth. Okay, let's hear your best elevator speech. And again, 2 minutes, and we'll start with the pro side. I assume you're going to split the... Okay, go ahead.
So I'll give the pro side. I just want to point out that Sheila will answer any facts, but I will speak to the pro side. My name is Mike Heinisch. First of all, I want to just take a moment to commend the league on your work, your legacy over the years in education, election issues like this, in registration of voters, and in other educational activities you have done for generations in communities across the country. So my commendations. Best Start for Kids represents an opportunity we've never had in King County. I've been in social services in King County as an executive director now of a youth agency in South King County for 35 years. And I have to tell you, we have never invested upstream. We have always invested in intervention and treatment. We have always invested downstream, and the result has been many failed lives. Look at the numbers in King County Jail. Look at the admissions, the readmissions to Harborview. 75% of the King County budget is now comprised of juminal justice related costs, criminal justice related costs. 75% of your tax dollars are raised in King County. Property tax and sales tax goes to criminal justice. And 80 to 90% of those people, their problems began in childhood with adverse childhood conditions that they lived with and experiences they had early in life. Best Starts gives an opportunity to invest in prevention and intervention, something that's not been done, really nationally, has not been done to the extent that Best Starts represents in this community ever. It's based on best practices and proven approaches. We have a wealth of research data in this community coming out of the University of Washington in particular that demonstrates to us that investing early in kids' lives, 50% will go to early childhood investments, investing in school-age kids, 35% will go to school-age kids' investments and other investments early and often, and with great application, will reduce those criminal justice costs, will provide for better lives for all kids growing up today.
Thank you. Okay, and Con, 2 minutes.
No, thank you. The county has failed its primary obligations. The county executive's first budget late in 2014 cut 500 positions out of various agencies, including social and health services, and the majority of them out of 200 out of the sheriff's office. Despite that, they've gone on with things that are of major proportion that will have to be funded by some continuing revenue stream in the future. And by continuing, I mean more than 9 years. The second difficulty is that 18% of the county's budget comes from property taxes. We're experiencing unprecedented property tax inflation. I got mine today, the notice over the weekend, and it's up 11%. It would seem that that would give the county some flexibility. But more and more we go to government by levy, which is an invitation to instability. Levies can fail even in Seattle. Nor does it ensure that that property tax level will be the same. What if we return to 2006? If you look at what's going on in the economic world right now or the stock market, anything of that sort, it's very unstable. The initiative is vague. In at least three places, it says that these funds are to be allocated after the initiative is passed. What budget document do you know of that people have to pass it and then they don't know how it's going to be spent in detail? I'll leave that as the openers now.
Thank you, both of you. All of you. So going on now to the league questions. These are league generated. What do you think is the greatest benefit or concern that voters should be aware of regarding this measure? You'll have 90 seconds. We'll start with you.
The greatest concern is, you know, it's not the intent. No one can fault the intent of this piece of legislation. But it's in execution. There are an unnamed number of communities, many of them small, that are not identified that are going to receive these monies. They're presumably all going to be open to all the services described, which are at least a half dozen, maybe a dozen. How is it going to be audited? Is it by the county, and is it in the county budget? Or is it each of these entities are expected to provide an audit on time? And if it's local government, how are they get paid for it? The evaluation, $22 million, I beg your pardon, that's enough to hire 200 people for a year at $100,000 each to evaluate this. And where are the comparables? What's the comparable between homelessness and pregnant mothers? Some of the homeless are going to be pregnant, to be sure, but not many. What you have here is a initiative that uses up, if the transportation initiative passes, $700 million. You will have used up all of the county's extra super levy quota, another 25% above the normal quota. What happens to the 160 bridges in King County that need maintenance? I brought with me a picture from the Times Monday, just saying that they may need $100 million to rejuvenate the King County Courthouse or face much more than that in cost.
Thank you. Okay, to the pro side, and again, 90 seconds.
The greatest the greatest benefit of this is, as far as I can, as I see it, is the county historically has funded programs. As an agency director at Kent Youth and Family Services, I report numbers to the county. That's the measure, not an outcome. I mean, I give you a narrative, the county narrative. What they want is a number. How many children were used by my dollar? This opportunity in Best Starts is going to pay for outcomes. It's similar to paying for quality in medical care, in the health care that the Affordable Care Act now is emphasizing. We're going to be held accountable for outcomes the way we haven't before, and not just numbers. And if performance isn't there, there's not going to be a program that's going to try to provide those outcomes, at least in my agency, and I'm clear about that. And the evaluation is another powerful instrument that will demonstrate to you, the voters, to the taxpayers, including me, and including the two of my colleagues sitting on both sides of me, that this, in fact, is effective. I don't see a downside to this, aside from it not passing.
Thank you. Next question. How much of the services in the levy will be provided by private organizations, and how much by public organizations? You have 1 minute, and let's start with the pro side.
It's actually a fairly quick answer. The majority of the funds are at this point planned to go back out into the community. There is a designated part that will firm up our services in public health to pregnant women, maternity support services, and the nurse family partnership. These are both programs that get out into community and do home visits with pregnant women. About 11% of that early investment goes towards public. The rest of it we're putting out into the community.
Thank you. And the con?
The levy, at one point, is to be used, I think it's the maternity side, is to be used in 4 years. What happens for the remaining 3 years scheduled? There's no inflationary increase built in the last 3 years. What do we do about that, or did the agencies and operations just take another cut? Who decides who benefits? There are two advisory committees that are to be set up. Are they naming them, or is the King County executive naming them after the fact? It's unlikely that the council is. This is clearly an executive-led initiative. In my view, at least, people 24 years old aren't kids. It's nice to name initiatives and proposals for kids, but part of this constituency isn't kids.
Thank you. And I think this next question actually kind of goes to one of your points. This initiative covers a broad range of services, and most of the providers have not been described. It is to be a mix of public and private services. With such a large and far-reaching undertaking, what is the oversight model, and is it sufficient? And this is 90 minutes. We'll start with the con side.
We're back to accountability.
There's $3 million in there for neuroscience at the University of Washington to evaluate what the data say about what direction should be taken in the future to ensure that these programs are more effective. Where are the precedents? If they were there, those that were the applicants to the King County Council spoke before it, should have said what they were. Thirdly, wouldn't it be better to have a initiative that said, talked in terms of $200 million, half as many communities, half as much coordination, and a database that was broad enough to give you the answers? The trouble with this initiative is that everything has been thrown into it at once. They're non-comparables, and the evaluation, surely $22 million worth of it, is not going to tell us a lot.
Thank you. And the pro side.
I want to have a point of clarification. The research dollars that you reference are not a part of the final ordinance package that went through the City Council. County Council, excuse me. And it did go through the county council, the ordinance that the council will appoint some of the members to the advisory board, as well as the executive appointing members to the advisory board, and then a group that are recommended by staff coming through and community recommendation. I know that it is difficult to wrap your head around a little bit this idea that providers are not identified ahead of the time of the levy passing. One of the desires of this levy is to get deeply into community and engage community in a very different way than the county has before. So rather than the government saying, we will pick the people right now who will receive these dollars, we want to hear from the community about what the community feels its needs are. King County is a very large county geographically. It is very different where the different cities are, and the needs are very, very different between Enumclaw and City of Seattle and Snoqualmie Valley. Very, very, and Vashon Island, very different communities. And so we have an ability to respond to what communities identify they need. Accountability and the Oversight Committee will have representation from all parts of King County. It will not be Seattle-centric, it won't be South County-centric, it will be representative from the entire county.
Thank you. This is the last one of our prepared questions, and then we'll take questions from the audience, so get busy out there. Some voters are wary of the money being spent to gather information about the clients using both private and public organizations. Are there any assurances in place that in this measure that the client information collected remains confidential? And this is a minute, and we'll start with the pro.
Well, all information that comes about individual is private through the county. Certainly any funding that goes through the Department of, through Community and Health Services and goes through public health are mandated to follow the HIPAA requirements, which is a federal mandate around privacy. Anyone who's gone to the doctor's office has been handed this information. So even there will be data sharing agreements with organizations, and even now there's a mandate to protect individual information.
And I can follow up on that by saying all the data that provider agencies, county, city, state, you name the jurisdiction, United Way, gather are de-identified under HIPAA, under FERPA, which is the education confidentiality law, and other laws that apply. So this is not identifiable data that we'll gather proving that this opportunity works.
Thank you. Con.
Some of the providers are going to be hired for 1 year. So every year you lack, at the end of the year, you lack continuity, and there's turnover. I find it difficult to understand how programs can have maximum effectiveness when you're doing 1 year contracts and different people are coming in and trying to perform the task. You also have the matter of coordination, which the word is used often. I read through the King County Council's the summaries of the meetings that were held on the issue, and coordination is put very vaguely, much like the allocation of money, much like who does the auditing. It's a blanket approach. I'm assuming that two members of the council, at least, were up for re-election, felt they had to vote for this. There are so many constituencies put in here in a presidential year that it's very hard to say no. That's different than having a valid program put together.
Okay, thank you. Now I'm going to go to audience questions, and I will direct them, I think, to the side that it really, I'll start with that anyway. So, but, you want somebody. Okay. You'll have 1 minute to respond to each one of these. So first, and I think this is directed first anyway to the pro side. Can you give some specific examples of how the dollars will be spent to prevent the issues that develop later in children that you mentioned in your elevator speech?
So some specific examples for In my previous role, I was an executive director of an organization that served low-income pregnant women and their babies. What we know from the neuroscience is that that early time, 0 to 5, is when 90% of the brain is developed. So the types of programs that would be funded in there are community-based programs that are serving pregnant women, serving babies, serving families, that are designed to help parents and their children be able to meet that maximum development, have all of the good things that can happen to them. So an example may be a community-based home visiting program, where they are paired with a peer counselor who has received training to provide that kind of support and can visit with them weekly, teaching them and helping them learn about good childcare, helping the family and the parents know that they need to also keep their own health well, basically parent coaching types of programs. Later on, there may be programs that are also community-based around a specific ethnic community and working with youth. How do you keep youth off the street and being good with their time, doing well in school? So maybe it's a mentoring program for a particular community. There's lots of room for the community to say, this is what works for us. This is what we need to see and what we need to see more of. That will be both evidence-based programs and promising practice programs.
Thank you. Con, please.
I had the good judgment to become chairman of the Senate Ways and Means Committee 1 week before the 81-83 recession was declared official. And in the next 20 months, we cut and taxed $1.2 billion to make up the deficit. The state budget at that time was about $12 billion. The point being that any bill that came out of any other committee in the Senate, and I think there's a similar rule in the House now, worth costing more than $50,000 had to have a price tag attached to it and had to go to the appropriations, or in the case of the Senate, the Ways and Means Committee. A lot of these items are not priced out. The cost of hiring the contractors 1 year at a time and longer is essentially open. The money will have to be reallocated again. And repeatedly, the word developing strategies, quote unquote, is used in here. Presumably, the promoters of the initiative had an idea what they wanted to do. Why are we now figuring out strategies after the fact and trying to figure out about outcomes and what happens down the road? Down the road, it's obvious we run out of money. You have to renew it, and you can't because you may have reached the levy lid.
Okay, thank you. Next question. The City of Seattle funds 50 positions for the Nurse Family Partnership. Will those Seattle positions be picked up by this levy, or will Seattle be paying twice? And let's start with the con.
I had a long staff with King County Council staff last week, and they insist that prior to the downturn in funding for health agencies and social agencies that started in 2008, that number has been increased by $50 million net. $50 million as a share of social and health services portion of the budget isn't very much, but nevertheless, they're ahead, and other agencies that are the guts of county government, beginning with law enforcement, are still way behind. There are inequities across the board here, brought about by the number of different functions that are supposed to be performed all at once. We're going to end homelessness in King County in 5 years. We funded the projects for 4 years.
Thank you. And the question is, will the levy also support the 50 positions that City of Seattle is paying for?
The money for Best Starts for Kids will not supplant anything that's already being funded. It will shore up the programs that exist in public health, but it will also expand that. We keep talking about the recession that happened in 2008. I will tell you, as an executive of a community-based organization, as our economy tanked, so did people's well-being and the amount of people who needed additional help. So that help, the need for help has not changed in the last few years. It is actually going up, so there's even more need for things like the Nurse Family Partnership. So there will not be replacement of that city. There will be expansion to try and meet the need that's out there.
Thank you. And then another question, and this we're going to start with the pro side. Even with passage of Best Starts levy, public health centers remain at risk. Programs using levy funds have yet to be defined. No reporting requirements have been established. So the question is, instead of creating a new level of bureaucracy, why not support existing agencies and incorporate new ideas into those agencies? One minute.
I was trying to decide exactly how to answer that. Best Starts for Kids is not designed to keep the public health centers open. So that's one of the things that people have to be very clear about. I will repeat that. Best Starts for Kids is not designed to keep the public health centers open. What it will do is provide for services that occur right now at our public health centers. But it's very clear that we are in a situation where we need to be looking at other sources for dollars for our public health services that are out there. I can't remember the rest of the question. Is there another part to the question?
So, well, instead of creating a new level of bureaucracy, why not support existing agencies and incorporate new ideas into those agencies?
The only thing I can say about that is there's a difference in sort of how funding sources are used, and there's requirements and restrictions on how those funding sources are used. And the public health center's dollars are a very complex mix of federal, state, and local dollars in a way that makes it a unique funding situation.
And the con side, please.
Well, I need to apologize to my colleagues up here, and I didn't do it deliberately, but I lost my left hearing aid earlier this week, and with the echo, things are getting a little bit difficult. I think the question she asks is the question I would ask. Exactly how is all of this to be coordinated? The plethora of programs, the unnamed communities of non-specified size, And the whole thing is supposed to be coordinated and come off with a measurable progress. It's a little difficult to believe.
Okay, thank you. I actually think we need to move to your closing statement at this point. And you'll have each have a minute. And we started with the pro, so I'm going to go ahead and start with the con. Do you want to take a minute just to wrap things up? That's George.
Yes.
You ought to have some philosophic reservations about this proposal, too. The state constitution describes local governments as, quote, creatures of the state, and therefore imposes limits on different revenue sources allocated to them. That's in the interests of evening out the resources between rich districts and poor. It hasn't succeeded as far as education is concerned, as we've found out, or that the High Court told us recently. The first question to be raised about the initiative is, are we moving toward government by initiative, one in which initiatives have to be mandatorily renewed because there isn't money in the regular operating budget for them, even if we're up against the limit and we can't put the initiative out? The second question is, what is the participation level, and it's been continuously falling since 1952, of the voter? You impose $400 million on the homeowners of this county, and how many people does it, what fraction of the voters does it take to pass this levy? 10%? There are situations in this county now that people win primaries with 11% of the adults.
Thank you. Go ahead, Proside, 1 minute.
Well, thank you for the opportunity tonight on behalf of the Pro Best Starts for Kids Proposition 1. I'm delighted to be here. I'll say what I said when I started. This is an opportunity, a new opportunity, a new way of doing business. We have not tried this before. It's time to try to really change the course of the kids in our community across King County. I want to point out that there are clearly defined strategies and high-level outcomes in Best Starts for Kids. If you go to the kingcounty.gov website and search for Best Starts, you'll be able to see those for yourself. They are at a high level. There is a full-length implementation planning process that will happen after the levy is successful on the ballot, which is not unusual at all to have that kind of a form of initiative on the ballot. I'll also say to you, I was part of the leadership team to help put together this levy, and exactly 1 year ago to the Thursday it was, September 11th, was the first time we met. And we were asked what we thought of this potential idea. And we were told it's a new way of doing business. And as I said a couple times, I'm the executive director of a youth agency in King County, Kent Youth and Family Services. I receive funding from King County government, other levels of government. Many people could say, I'm in this on the pro side because I'll get my services funded. I'll have a job, my staff will have it funded. I said at that meeting when the microphone was handed to me, and it was my turn to say what did I think, I said, I support a new way of doing business. Let's do it right for kids. If it means I'm gone, I'm gone. And you can ask anybody, I'll tell you who was at that meeting, I said that. This is a once in a generation opportunity. It's a once in a lifetime opportunity for kids who can't even vote. Let's give them that opportunity and vote yes for Proposition 1.
Thank you, and let's give a great round of applause to our panel. Thank you for coming. And now we'll move on to our next panel. These are now the Seattle measures. And we're gonna begin with the Seattle Transportation Levy. Oh yeah.
That's me.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Hello, I'm Elliot.
Eugene.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, I'm Abigail.
Nice to see you. I had no idea we were going to be filmed tonight, so we're going to, it's our big break.
No, we're going to be famous for all those people who watch the Seattle Journal, King County TV, which is actually surprises you how many people end up flipping
late at night. Channels.
Okay, well, I'll introduce the spokespeople on the transportation levy. Representing the pro side, we have Elliot Helmbrecht and Abigail Dorr. Opposition is Eugene Wasserman. Welcome.
Thank you.
The ballot title is as follows. The City of Seattle Proposition 1 concerns replacing funding for citywide transportation maintenance and improvements. If approved, this proposition would replace an expiring levy and would fund bridge seismic upgrades, transit corridor, and light rail access projects, pedestrian and bicycle safety projects, synchronized traffic signals. Nice. I had to come from Lower Queen Anne up here, and that Denny Way, I mean, I'm looking at all the way down, it's red, 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 my light's green. No one's going anywhere. Anyway. Okay, lost my place. All right, street maintenance and repair, freight projects, and neighborhood street projects. It allows for maximum collections of $95 million in 2016 and $930 million over the nine-year period. The 2016 total regular tax limit would be $3.60 per 1,000 assessed value, including approximately 62 cents per 1,000 assessed value in additional taxes. The proceeds from this property tax levy lid lift, proposed by the mayor and passed by the city council, are to be used solely for Seattle transportation improvements, identified in three core categories: safe routes programs, $207 million, congestion relief programs, $303 million, and maintenance and repair programs, $420 million. So beginning with the pro side, you have 2 minutes to give your best elevator speech, but before you do that, if you could also introduce yourselves and tell us who you're representing here. And let's start, with the pro side. Thank you.
My name is Abigail Dorr. I'm a volunteer with the Let's Move Seattle campaign, and I first want to thank you all for hosting this. I think it's a really great forum, and we're pleased to be here.
Thank you, and my name is Elliot Helmbrecht, and I am the campaign manager for the Let's Move Seattle Transportation Levy. Do you want 2 minutes to start now, or should we introduce Eugene first? Or?
I'll let him introduce himself when it's his turn.
Okay, perfect. Like Abigail said, thank you so much for coming here tonight. We're excited to talk to you about the levy. The Let's Move Seattle Transportation Levy is our plan for a modern, more effective transportation network throughout Seattle that will give all of us more choices to start moving around our city more quickly, efficiently, and safely. But before I talk to you about the levy, I want to go back to 2006 when we all passed the Bridging the Gap transportation levy. In that time, in that 9 years, SDOT has delivered on the promises that we came out here 9 years ago and promised to all of you. We've delivered on all of those except one, which is guardrails, an interesting tidbit, and I'll explain that later. Fast forward to today, we're a rapidly growing city. 10,000 people are moving here every year, and our transportation system is designed for the 50s and 60s when only cars and trucks use the road. So it's receiving a lot of stress from all the new people and a lot of the growth. So we need to look forward and put together a plan, which our new mayor and new leadership at SDOT did with the Let's Move Seattle levy, incorporating the plans that have been out in the community, have gotten community support for years, the pedestrian master plan, the transit master plan, and the transit master plan, and put together this levy. And like it was mentioned, there are three priorities. There's relieving congestion, maintenance and repair, and safety. And we can get into what those projects are, but each of those categories has specific projects that the SDOT will fulfill over the 9 years, like they've proven they've done with the Bridging the Gap levy. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. And Eugene, if you could.
Hi. I'm Eugene Wasserman. I'm the campaign coordinator for Keep Seattle Affordable, No on Prop 1. Many of you might have been here 2 years ago when we spoke in favor, a group of us that are connected with this project, also in favor of district elections. So the group behind this has been around in Seattle elections for a long time. So that's who I am. I think a pretty picture was painted here of things that are just not true. The Bridging the Gap levy didn't produce the things they promised. One example is the Land Street overpass, which was not done, and there are many more. They later changed the metrics after the levy was passed, and that's why they can claim they can make those metrics that they claim. This is an overall tax increase. It's the largest tax levy in the city's history. Our review of the ordinance shows that that's what it is. It's a tax increase for transportation. The projects that are listed in the ordinance and attachment A and also on the various websites are things that are only examples. The city's not mandatory to pass it. For the second time, we will have a 9-year levy that has no actual deliverables other than they will spend money in certain categories. So we think there's a lack of accountability in this program and in this levy. There's no overall transportation program in the city. They cited two or three plans, which are separate plans, which are not coordinated with other plans. I should know this because I represent an industrial association and works on this all the time. We're afraid that Seattle's becoming unaffordable. This and the parks levy will add 36% to your property taxes just for these two, the park levy and this. This is a 155 increase over the previous Bridging the Gap levy, which actually the backlog increased since they started. So we think there's a lack of accountability and a lack of deliverability and trust, and that's why you should vote against it.
Thank you. And now lead questions first. And this is 2 minutes you'll have to answer. The levy provides for core categories of spending. However, the categories can be changed by up to 10% of the amount listed for each category after the Oversight Committee has had a chance to comment, and by more than 10% by a three-quarter vote of the Council. Further, the spending breakdown, attachment A to the levy, is characterized as a list of anticipated deliverables, anticipated spending amounts, and anticipated revenue sources, and is illustrative only. Why should voters believe the projects we think are promised will be the projects we actually get? We'll start with the con side.
I guess I would say I totally agree with your question. I mean, there's nothing more to it. It says in the ordinance that the projects are there for illustrative reasons and are not mandatory. This is the first guess that this is just a tax increase that allows them to spend the money the way they want. Also, because the Seattle Department of Transportation gets a lot of general fund money, money that could be, they can move the money between the two categories easily and you wouldn't know the difference. One point I want to point out in terms of accountability, you just have to look at the seawall debacle. There are $71 million over on a $300 million project, and yet they didn't bother telling the public till 2 months after they knew so this levy would go through, because they knew the Council would not approve a levy with that kind of overhang. You just have to look outside on Broadway at the streetcar tracks that was supposed to have streetcars going in 2014. They're not there, and they don't know when they'll be there because the electronics don't work. So I would agree with the premise of the question. There's a lack of accountability. There are no promises in this other than they will spend $930 million. And I can guarantee you they will spend that. They will deliver the money, and that's about it.
All right, thank you. Go ahead, ProSide. 2 minutes.
All right, so I'm going to try to respond to all that in 2 minutes. But if you want to know exactly about which projects are going to take place in your neighborhood and get invested in your neighborhood, you can look at the website because there is a list of projects. They all require specific design. They all require specific work before they can be implemented, and that's why there are those clauses that say we have categories for spending in certain amounts. But there also has to be some flexibility built into a 9-year levy. 9 years ago, we didn't have Seattle greenways to make it easier for people to walk around their neighborhoods. That wasn't invented yet. And in 9 years, we could have more great resources like that that we need to spend that money on. But every single dollar in the Let's Move Seattle levy, $930 million, is categorized to a certain category. That money has to be spent on safe routes to schools. That money has to be spent on maintenance and repair. That money has to be spent on repaving your roads. And like it was mentioned, any deviation from that requires a council, 3/4 of a council approval. That is not going to be easy to do. So that money is going to be spent on those categories that you are voting for. We are also coming out here and telling you about the projects that are going to happen. I can go on and on about the new rapid ride corridors, the new sidewalks, and the new Safe Routes to Schools projects, and you guys can hold us accountable to that. We delivered on bridging the gap promises that were promised 9 years ago. SDOT has proven that they can manage these projects effectively, and the oversight committee that is in place with the Bridging the Gap levy has also agreed with this transportation levy, and they've said that SDOT has been a good steward of your public money, your property tax money, over the last 9 years with replacing your sidewalks, with repaving your roads, and with the kinds of projects that are within this levy. I think I answered all of them, but Abigail, do you have...
Yeah, I just want to add that the League of Women Voters has been crucial in advocating to ensure that we have accountability programs in all of our oversight committees. And the Bridging the Gap Levy Oversight Committee was one of the most successful programs, and it's that strength of that program will continue through this upcoming levy.
Okay, thank you. Next question, 90 seconds on this one. We're starting with the pro side. Special levies and bonds are historically the preferred method of funding capital projects For instance, permanent or at least long-term improvements. This levy clearly states that a large portion of the money will be going to the maintenance backlog for key roads and bridges. Shouldn't maintenance money come from the general fund or at least a permanent source of funding?
So we are in an unfortunate situation here in Washington State, is we are restricted on where we can generate revenue from. Tim Iman has really limited our ability about where we can generate revenue. And a majority of the funding in this package is dedicated to major maintenance. We have some serious maintenance needs in our cities. Our bridges need seismic retrofits all over the city, and this will provide that crucial funding to ensure the stability of our infrastructure. The size of this package is so important because we went out and asked our community, what do we want? We want to live in a livable city where we can walk around safely, ride the bus safely to get everywhere around our city. And what SDOT and what the city is responding with is a package that is the city we want to live in. Not just we want to cover our basic maintenance needs, but we also want to make sure we can get around our city safely, not stuck in traffic, have reliable bus service and transit service, and that's the vision that this package is moving us forward on.
Thank you. Con side, yes. Oh, a minute, oh wait. 90 seconds.
I just want to say one thing. I have here the ordinance for that backs the levy up that will be used in law. And the pro side has come out here and not read the ordinance. Each little category they mentioned doesn't have a separate appropriation in here. So I just want to make that point, that you are not being told what's really in the ordinance. And you're also, and I agree, this is about the only city that uses levies for transportation projects, and specifically for maintenance. It's a continual problem with the city that they don't use general funds to do this. We have all this growth downtown in South Lake Union, and yet where is the money for that growth, and why isn't it being used to do these things? Why is the city and the mayor and his developer friends always coming back to the taxpayers to pay for these things that many of us think should be paid for by the people building these projects and making the money? Are we here to make Bezos another $1 billion on the backs of the city taxpayers? And that's what this is about. And I just think that, you know, the pro side keeps saying, well, it's for maintenance, but it's for this, it's for that, it's for everything. But it's not for anything. It's just a general tax increase, and that's all it is. And all these promises are just promises by people that they won't be here in 9 years, and hopefully neither will I. But the point is, the people who voted on this lame duck council will not be here to be held accountable.
Okay, and that actually leads into a question, and let me just ask it from the group here, from our audience. We'll start with the pro side again. Would it be better to have the new council that represents the districts choose the levy amount and the projects? And a minute for that each.
So this current Let's Move Seattle proposal was unanimously supported by a current council. So it did get unanimous support after it had moved through the council and got that support. What I would say to that is this levy is going to benefit from all of our new district council members. After this election, next year and coming years, when you want to advocate for neighborhood issues and neighborhood projects, you're going to have one district representative to go to. Our transportation chair has been great, but now you're going to have someone that you can directly speak to, that you can call up and go meet with them at their office and talk to them about the projects and the sidewalks that you want to see. So yes, this levy is going to benefit immensely from having district representatives, because it's going to add another layer of accountability to that oversight committee that is appointed members of the community on there providing that oversight. So you'll have another level to make sure that this money is spent correctly in the way that it's intended, that is in the levy proposal. Thank you.
Gonside?
Since many of us in our group were involved in district elections, we feel that if there's a levy being proposed for 9 years, that the new city council elected in this November should be the ones approving it, not the previous city council, many of whom chose not to run and retire because of the overwhelming vote we had for districts that voted them out. So we think you should vote no and let the new council decide how, if any, a levy should be decided and who should vote on it. And it should go, if they want to do one, it could go back on the ballot next election.
Okay, thank you. The current levy is nearly $1 billion. At least one council member suggested an alternative that would come in at about $600 million, so roughly one-third less. Do you or do you not think reductions could have been made to overall cost, and why? Let's start with the con.
A good example of how it could have been reduced. Apparently, there was $71 million that they're using for the seawall that could have been used to reduce the levy. The mayor, when they announced the seawall overruns, they suddenly found $71 million that apparently none of us knew about, but they did. The question is, how many more pots of money is sitting around that could be used to reduce this levy? I don't know, you don't know, and do we trust them to tell us? That's why we want you to vote no and let the new council, who are not tied to the existing city government, take a crack at what we should do about our transportation problems.
Thank you. Pro, please.
I want to make one slight correction to that statement. It wasn't a total reduction to the size of the levy that the council was offering. It was to look at different funding sources. And what the council was looking at was, what are the basic needs we need to maintain our city? And then they went to the public. SDOT did significant community outreach on what our priorities are as a city. And what they heard time and time again is, we are a growing city and we need more infrastructure, safer ways to walk around our city, more bus service. And that's what SDOT is providing us. And this is the model and this is the vision we want to see our city look like. We're sick of being stuck in traffic. We want to literally move our city around, and that's good for our economy, that's good for our local businesses, that's good for young people moving to the city so that we know that we can get to our jobs on time. And that's one of the biggest reasons I know I moved here, and I understand Elliot moved here too, is because this is a growing city, this is a vibrant city, and we're not going to get there if we don't continue to invest in that infrastructure.
I will just add too, we go around to these community events and different forums and events, and we often get asked, do you support the Move Seattle levy? And all of the candidates running do as well. And as far as I've seen, they all are mostly on board with this Move Seattle levy. So I encourage you to ask, but I would bet that whoever wins next year and in this election, they're also going to support that Move Seattle levy too. But I would encourage you to ask them.
Okay. I think one more question, you may already have sort of touched on this, but let's be specific. Should the city be utilizing impact or linkage fees in lieu of a property tax? Why or why not? And let's start with the pro side.
Yeah, so I certainly think that the developer impact fees is something that the city is going to be using in the future. I think the funding source we have for this opportunity is it's a property tax. And two-thirds of all of our property taxes are paid for by commercial businesses and commercial owners. What was the other part of the question? And developer impact fees. So there are limitations for what we can do with developer impact fees. They can only be used on certain areas, and they cannot be used for operations. But I think in the next few years, you're going to see this new council coming in look at the option of a developer impact fee. And I also want to add one thing about affordability. The two biggest household costs for a family, number one is housing, and the second is transportation. That's fuel, gas, parking, bus passes. And what this levy does is it gives more opportunities for transportation options outside of a single occupancy vehicle. And that is huge. That means that a family can get around their city with more, our city, our lovely city, with more transportation choices. And that means having one less vehicle in the family, one less parking ticket to pay, one less tank of gas that they need to pay. And that's what an affordable city looks like. That's what a vibrant city looks like. And that's what's going to make young families be able to afford to stay here and live here.
Thank you. And the con, please? You want to talk about impact or linkage fees instead of property tax?
You have to wonder why the city has not imposed them before. Many cities in this region have imposed them for years, and yet this city continually refused to do it. But they rather have residential property owners pay these taxes than ask the development community to pay for it. You have to ask yourself why. I actually don't know. But it seems pretty weird, though, that, you know, the people backing this campaign, many of whom from the development community so far, the few that have, why they're backing it. Because they're not having to pay developer fees, because the mayor and the council want you to pay for these things. They want you to pay for growth. So I think you need to, once again, vote no, let the new council redecide this. There are a lot of promises made up here. I don't see how you passing this tax is going to make your life more affordable in Seattle. Show me where your bus costs are going to go down. They're not. You're going to be paying higher taxes for a very long time, for 9 years, and I'll bet you they'll come back in 9 years from now and say, well, things are even more screwed up than they were 9 years ago, as they were in bridging the gap, and we have to come back and ask you for more money. And that's why you should vote no. These are the same people that created traffic congestion that made it very difficult for all of us to get here. Let new people who didn't cause it have a chance at this.
Thank you. And I do think we have time for one more question. What specific projects will be completed with this levy? Why don't we start with the pro?
All right. So in our three categories, the first one is reducing congestion. What fits into that are 7 new bus rapid ride plus corridors throughout the city. Every district is getting at least one. Some are getting multiple. And what that means is you get transit, infrastructure improvements to make transit the preferred route of choice, so it's all easier and more accessible for all of us to get throughout our city to every single neighborhood. That's also increased light rail connections along our light rail lines. Throughout the second category, maintenance. Abigail talked about it. Seismic bridge improvements, they're crumbling. We're going to completely replace the Fairview Avenue Bridge, which is our oldest timber bridge. We're going to pave 180 miles of roads. We're going to fill our potholes. We're going to add 150 blocks of new sidewalks. And in safe routes and in safety, we have safe routes to schools at every public school, prioritized by low-income school neighborhoods. So let's make it easier for those kids to get to school who currently have a hard time and haven't had the investments. We also are going to prioritize our Vision Zero. Each year, 20 people die on our streets, and that is unacceptable. We can design our streets more smartly, so that is not the case. We make it our goal to get to zero deaths. Those are what we're coming out here to you guys and saying we'll deliver on. SDOT has shown with Bridging the Gap that they can deliver on these types of priorities. You can go to our website to find the full list of facts. And this is a bold proposal. But for the average homeowner, this is an additional $12 a month. And I think we're getting a value for that $12. Go to our website, see the projects listed, and you'll get to see the projects in your specific neighborhoods as well.
Thank you. Con, please.
I think if you go look at the ordinance, many of the projects you just described are not in the ordinance of things they have to do. There are three categories, and that's it. And I think if you look at the list of projects, they're only illustrative, as your moderator said, not I. But it's on page 8, where they very clearly state these projects are not mandatory. This is a general tax increase for transportation. They have to spend it on transportation. What you get for it is a whole nother story. And you can see how SDOT delivers on projects. Just look at the tracks out there. Besides the fact of the debacle of that whole project and tearing up Broadway, where are the streetcars? They're not there. They were promised in 2014. So the list is not really there. Their ability to deliver on time projects as they said they would are not there. And that's what we need a way to see. There are new leadership at SDOT and there's a new mayor. Let them prove they can deliver before we give them $1 billion. Remember, that's what this is about. It's a lot of money, close to $1 billion. And we have not seen many projects around here that are actually on time, on budget. And if we don't hold people accountable, and if you don't vote no, there'll be no projects on time, on budget, because there'll be no pressure to do it. We gotta make a stand here and make sure that they come back a levy with actual projects and actual dates when they're gonna deliver them and actual costs.
Thank you. Now we will wrap up, so you each will have a minute to do a final wrap up. So let's start with the con.
We're asking you to vote no because this is just a general tax increase for 9 years. You have to ask why they didn't do it for 4 or 5 or some reasonable period to hold people accountable. It's because they didn't want to be held accountable. They just want the money and they want to decide for you what they're going to do with it. I sat in those community meetings. In fact, I ran 2 of them. It was not what we wanted, is what they told us we were going to get. This was not a community participation project. You just have to ask yourself, when are we going to hold people accountable? And the one point, big point I want to make, and I want to save it for the end, in the previous Bridging the Gap levy that they described so wonderfully, which others have doubts, there was a prohibition that the money could not be used to bail out Bertha, though it was used in different terms. They took that provision out in this. So the money in this levy could be used to bail out Bertha. And the state's going to be coming to us for that, you bet your life. So we urge you to vote no, let the new council deal with this problem, and we'll see what they come up with.
Thank you. Okay, Proside, 1 minute.
I will respond really quickly and say that the money cannot be used for Bertha. It also is not, there's no money for streetcar, and there's no money for seawall repair cost overruns in this levy. I want to thank you all for coming here tonight. I've had a really good time talking to you about the levy. Like I said, there are a lot of projects in this levy, and you can go to our website and take a look at them, see what it's coming to your neighborhood. But this levy really is about creating the city that we want to see going forward. This is a visionary statement. This is a bold proposal from the city to say our city should be more accessible for all users. No matter what use you're traveling, whether it's foot, car, transit, bike, you name it, you should be able to get around the city safely, efficiently, and affordably. And this plan does it. And SDOT has shown that they can deliver on these types of projects. We did it with Bridging the Gap. We can do it with the Let's Move Seattle levy. We have a good plan, and that's why so many organizations have endorsed us. We've got the 46th District Democrats, the 34th District Democrats, the Washington Conservation Voters, Labor with and the Transit Riders Union. We've got business with the Seattle Chamber, and we've got a whole bunch of other environmental and social justice organizations backed behind this levy because they know this is what we need to move forward. This is what Seattle needs now, and this is what we can vote for in November. Thank you.
Thank you, and let's give a great thank you to our panel. And now we are going to have our final measure of the night, which is Seattle Initiative 122, otherwise known as the Honest Elections Initiative. And can our speakers on that please come forward? Heather Weiner and Matt Wald. Yeah, don't go this way. So on the pro side, we have Heather Weiner, and the con side, we have Matt Wald. First, a brief summary. The ballot title summary for Honest Elections is as follows. The City of Seattle Initiative Measure Number 122 concerns public participation in government, including publicly financed election campaigns and lobbying. If enacted, the measure would limit election campaign contributions from entities receiving city contracts totaling $250,000 or more, or from persons spending $5,000 or more for lobbying. It would require 24-hour reporting of electronic contributions, require paid signature gatherer identification, limit lobbying by former city officials, create a voluntary program for public campaign financing through $100 vouchers issued to registered voters, funded by 10 years of additional property taxes, with $3 million approximately 0.0194 cents, right, per 1,000, pardon? Yeah, per $1,000 assessed value collected in 2016. So starting with the pro side, please introduce yourself, say who you're representing, and then go ahead and give us your two-minute opening.
Thank you very much for inviting us to speak about Honest Elections I-122. It's on our ballots this fall, and it's probably the last thing, as you flip your ballot over, it's probably one of the very last things to vote on during this crowded election. So thank you very much for the time to hear about it. I-122, first let me tell you who it's endorsed by. It is endorsed by nearly every candidate currently running for city council, including City Councilman Tim Burgess. It is endorsed by two former Seattle Ethics and Elections Commissioners. It is endorsed by Congressman Jim McDermott, who is a national leader on campaign finance reform, and a long list of progressive women's and civic engagement organizations like Planned Parenthood. I-122 does four things to limit the power of big money interests and strengthen the voices of ordinary voters in city government. It limits the influence of big money, and we'll talk about how it does that in a minute. It increases accountability and transparency. It ensures candidates focus more on voters than on dialing for dollars. And it gives ordinary people like you and me a stronger voice in City Hall. It costs $3 million a year, an amount that is so small that it could be done either through a levy or from the City Council's general fund, from the general budget, which is worth more than $1 billion a year. It is an innovative program, and it is a program that takes what we have learned from other campaign finance reform success stories around the country, like New York and San Francisco, LA, and takes that program and implements some of the best practices that we have learned from those other cities and states, and makes sure that we keep Seattle of, by, and for the people. I'm really looking forward to hearing your questions. Thank you.
And wait, before you, and tell us who you're here representing? Or?
So again, my name is Heather Weiner, and I am the campaign director for Honest Elections Seattle. Yes, on I-122.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Matthew Wald. I am the campaign manager for No Election Vouchers. That's No on Initiative 122. I want to also thank you for allowing us the opportunity to come and present tonight and talk about this really important initiative that you're going to see on your ballot in November. I want to start by saying that I think campaign finance reform is a really important issue. There are a lot of things that I think we need to change about our electoral system. I think Citizens United was one of the worst decisions the Supreme Court has ever handed down in history. I don't think money is speech, and I don't think corporations are people. But here in Seattle, we actually have some of the lowest contribution limits in the country. We have a very strong and independent Ethics and Elections Commission, and Seattle's one of the least corrupt cities in the country as well. And so this initiative is really trying to solve a problem that doesn't really exist. And the core of the measure is these democracy vouchers. So it raises property taxes to provide registered voters with four $25 vouchers that they can then donate to candidates that they support. The problem is that there's many loopholes that allow special interests to abuse the system, and it's gonna have a host of unintended consequences. I think the backers were well-intentioned when they created it, but I think as we talk about some of the nuances of the initiative, such as the fact that it's gonna push more money into less accountable and less transparent independent expenditures, the spending limits that it has are toothless because there's a loophole that allows candidates to double dip, taking the full amount of taxpayer-funded vouchers while also raising unlimited additional campaign cash. So as we talk about these nuances, I hope you'll join me in voting no, because you'll see that the unintended consequences are just too severe.
Thank you. So the first question is, what kind of an impact do you believe that this measure, if passed, will have on the competitiveness of campaigns in Seattle? And you'll have 90 seconds. Let's start with the con side.
Sure. So I think the proponents would argue that this is going to empower people, but I think, in fact, it's going to do the opposite, because there's a very complicated administrative process for these vouchers. These vouchers are going to be mailed out at the very beginning of the year. So candidates who are incumbents, who have high name recognition, or are supported by well-organized and well-funded special interest groups are going to benefit most from these vouchers. If you're a candidate who declares later in the cycle, or you don't have the high name recognition that incumbents or other candidates do, then that's going to severely limit your ability to go out and raise these vouchers. So incumbents and candidates backed by special interest groups are going to be able to monopolize the voucher money, and it won't be left for other candidates who need it to potentially be successful. So I think it's actually going to dampen the competitiveness of our elections.
Thank you. On the pro side, please. 90 seconds.
One of the issues and one of the big problems that we have here in Seattle is a problem of candidates realizing that it is too expensive to run. It's really expensive to run here in Seattle, and we've seen that with unprecedented levels of spending in this primary election now when we're dealing with the district elections. And we have seen that stifle some really great candidates who wanted to run but weren't able to raise the money because they weren't incumbents or they didn't have linkages to big special interest groups. So one of the things that I-122 does is it encourages a more diverse candidate pool. We got halfway there with the district elections, and this takes us all the way there. One of the ways that it does that is it restricts the maximum amount of contributions from $700 to $500. And if you decide, and it's optional, to be in the public financing program, then you agree to a spending cap. And that means that you have an even playing field with your opponents because you all agree to the same spending cap. And you compete on your ability to talk to voters, not your ability to talk to funders and big money interests. And in that way, we can encourage people of all different diversities, of all different ethnicities, coming from all different neighborhoods, to run because they're good at talking to voters, not talking to people who can write big checks. That's what I-122 tries to do. Now, our opponents have made a lot of claims about what is wrong with I-22 and what they say are loopholes and how it's not going to work. But what we have seen is that public financing models across the country very much work to encourage diverse and excited, energized candidates run for council.
Thank you. Next question. Is there any possibility of the voucher process being corrupted or misused? Why or why not? And we'll start with the pro side.
So let's go ahead and explain the voucher system. Registered voters, would receive at the beginning of the year an envelope, much like what you receive with your current ballot. And at the beginning of the year, it would have four coupons in it that you, worth $25 each, that you can give to the candidate of your choice. Whoever it is that comes and knocks at your door, say you come to a League of Women Voters forum and you have four candidates here talking, and at the end they have four boxes, you can go over there and put your vouchers in and vote with your voucher for those candidates. If you lose your voucher, which I'm going to tell you I would probably do, you can go online or you can go and call to the Seattle Ethics and Elections Commission and talk to them about doing it electronically to assign that money. Can it be corrupted? No more than how the current mail-in ballot process is corrupted. This is what we heard from people who oppose voting rights, and this is what we've heard from people who have opposed mail-in ballots, that there's some kind of boogeyman that's going to come and corrupt the process and make it not work, that there's going to be fraud happening. We here in Seattle believe that we're generally pretty honest people, that our elections are generally pretty clean. What we want to do is to empower everyday voters and everyday candidates to engage in the democratic process. Now, one last thing to let you know about the vouchers. You write in the name of the candidate who you're choosing, and then you sign it with your signature, and your signature is verified just like it is on the mail-in ballot. It's the same process. It is just as trustworthy as the mail-in ballot process. And what that does is you are now engaged and you now have a personal connection, regardless of your income level, with a candidate who you support.
Thank you. Khan, please.
So when the proponents drafted this initiative, they actually made five new crimes with, I don't know if they're, I believe they're misdemeanors, with financial penalties, because they anticipate that there is going to be corruption, that there is going to be campaign shenanigans. If I were the campaign manager for an incumbent, the first person I would hire is a voucher collector to go around and collect money to fund my campaign. And so...
Let him finish his statement.
Thank you. The other problem is that special interest groups, while it is true that it's illegal to bundle, so entities cannot collect vouchers, they can very much direct vouchers to their preferred candidates. So if, you know, a special interest group has 3,000 members in Seattle, that's potentially $300,000 that they can steer to a preferred candidate. So it's a very powerful statement to be able to say, hey, you know, we can direct $100,000 to your campaign, and that infuses corruption into our otherwise relatively clean system. The other problem is that these vouchers are not fully paid for. And so only the people who are the most organized or the special interests who are the most well-funded will actually be able to utilize them, and that's not creating a fair system throughout the entire city, because there's 415,000 registered voters. That's $41.5 million. Yet this only funds vouchers at $6 million, and $1.3 million of that is for administrative costs. So only a fraction of voters are actually going to be able to use them. And the other problem is that voters who don't participate in the system now are not necessarily going to participate and have value to these vouchers. And I think there's a high incentive for them to trade them, sell them, do other scrupulous things with them. And so I think there's a lot of room for corruption.
Thank you. One of the stated goals of the Honest Elections campaign is to balance the political power of the wealthy and powerful special interests with that of regular people. Is there any possibility that the wealthy or campaign consultants for powerful interests could simply co-opt the voucher process? Why don't we start with you in the con side?
I'm sorry.
Co-opt the voucher process. So this would be, any possibility the wealthy or campaign consultants for powerful interests could co-opt the voucher process? I think it's essentially what you were saying before, is that someone could go and buy vouchers?
Yeah, I think, kind of echoing what I was saying before, I think, you know, there's a lot of opportunities for special interest groups to direct their vouchers, for people to sell their vouchers. And as I said before, I think the proponents anticipate problems because they have five new crimes that have penalties attached to the initiative. And the way it's written, it says, you know, if this portion is struck down, then this. And if this line is struck down, then this. So they anticipate a host of problems, even in their own writing of the initiative.
Thank you. Proside?
Okay, let's talk about how elections really work. The first person a candidate hires is their finance director, and that person goes and collects checks. And they're not checks for $25, they're checks for $700, right? They go to boardrooms and they get everybody around the boardroom table to write checks, maxed out checks. They have fundraisers in the same neighborhoods over and over and over again collecting checks. That's the first thing that a candidate does right now. The second thing that a candidate does is make sure that their policy positions are policy positions that answer what everybody who are writing the checks wants to hear. Under I-122, now what's going to have to happen is if a candidate, and it's optional, if they decide to participate in the program, have to make sure that their policy positions reflect what the voters want. Because what they are then doing is they might hire some organizers, they might hire people, they might decide that they themselves will go knocking door to door, but they have to sell themselves to the voters now, not to the people who have the big checkbooks. And what we're trying to do here, and what we will do, and what we have seen successfully done, is to balance the power of big money interests who currently have the ears and controls over our elected officials. Not necessarily in Seattle yet, but we want to make sure that we keep Seattle of, by, and for the voters and the people. Now, let me address two things that our opponents have said, and we've seen this all over the place. The first one is they say, you know, we can't really trust the voters with these. There's going to be fraud. They don't know how to use them. They even said, you know, in their voter guide statement, you'll see they say, people who are retirees won't understand how to use these. Come on. In fact, we think that this is going to be just as simple as signing your ballot.
Okay, and the flip side of the same question. Since the goal is to balance the political power of the wealthy and powerful special interests with that of regular people, if you think that I-122's vouchers won't work, what is your solution for getting big money out of local politics and rebalancing the power of average people? So let's start with the con.
One thing I alluded to earlier, Citizens United was the worst decision, one of the worst decisions that the Supreme Court has ever handed down. So one thing we could be doing is working to overturn that decision through a constitutional amendment. I know there is some effort to do that. I think we should have more of an effort to do that. We are not opposed to public financing of campaigns. Seattle used to have a public financing system, and there are various models of public financing that do potentially work and do have strong benefits. But this voucher system, which has never been done anywhere in the country, that is ripe for abuse, is just the wrong approach. And I think there are a lot of other things that we can be talking about to make our elections more fair, more honest. I think we can be talking about, let me backtrack a little bit. I think when we talk about contribution limits and spending, one of the problems is by lowering contributions from 700 to 500, which we're not necessarily opposed to, but that will push more money into independent expenditures, which are run by special interest groups, which are less accountable and less transparent. So I think we would rather have that money be funneled into traditional campaign structures where you can hold candidates accountable for who they're taking money from and their message. And pushing that into IEs doesn't do that.
Thank you. Pro-side, please.
Okay, two things. First one is, this will not push more money into independent expenditures. Citizens United, the Supreme Court said that there is very little that we, the people, can do to limit independent expenditures, big money PACs. Very little that we are allowed to do under the U.S. Supreme Court. So I-122 does everything that we can do. It requires more. It requires quicker disclosure and electronic disclosure of how money is being spent and who is putting money into those independent expenditures. And it does the one thing that we can do to fight back against big super PACs, and that is empower people, educate people, address low voter turnout by making sure that people feel invested, connected, and trusting of their system, of the election system. That's what I-122 does. Now let me say something. The question was, what else are you going to do to address this problem of big money in politics? And the opponents yesterday on KUOW said, you know, politicians don't really need more money. What they really need is just for voters to volunteer their time. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't have very much time to volunteer, and I can't imagine that the average voter who is working two jobs to afford his or her apartment here in Seattle and trying to make sure that the bus is going to be on time is going to have time to volunteer for a political candidate. That's not the answer. The answer is to pass I-122 to set limits on big money interest and to empower ordinary voters to have a stronger vote and a stronger voice in the process.
Thank you. And now we'll go to audience questions, and this is 90 seconds each. must all candidates abide by the cap, or can candidates still fund themselves the old-fashioned way by fundraisers and personal donors? And if a candidate does opt out, then what happens to the system? And we'll start, I think, with the pro. Thank you.
So under I-122, a candidate can voluntarily participate in the program. If, for example, I'm running for citywide office, like District 9, which, by the way, I am not, nor would I ever. If I was running and I opted into the system, I would agree to a spending cap of $300,000 for my campaign. I can raise that money from vouchers and from individuals and organizations as long as I comply with my spending cap and my spending level, right, of $300,000. My opponent, Matt, decides to not engage in the political process, in the public financing program, and he doesn't have to comply with a spending cap. He still can only raise $500 at a time, but he can spend as much as he wants. If, for some reason, he gets a huge flood of money or there's an independent expenditure from the Chamber of Commerce that's helping him, I'm not saying they're doing that, Matt, but let's just say, then what would happen is I could go to the SEC and ask them for a waiver, and this is the loophole that he's talking about. I can ask them for a waiver and to increase my spending limit so that I am not hurt or disadvantaged by my competition. That is why we are endorsed by two former SEC commission members, because they like that it gives the SEC the ability to make sure that the playing field is even and level. Now, going back to the rest of the question about what happens, can you restate, is there anything else on
that?
Well,
it was what happens to the system, what happens.
Right, so that's what happens to the system. They remain competitive. For a mayor, for the mayor's office, $800,000 a year. For a city attorney, it's $150,000 a year spending cap.
Go ahead, Matt, thanks.
So yes, that's the loophole that we're talking about here. It is an optional system. Candidates have to opt in. If you are a prolific fundraiser or you are a wealthy candidate, then you can raise and spend unlimited amounts of money. But if you do opt into the system, there is that loophole that if an IE enters the race, then you can raise the full amount of taxpayer-funded vouchers, and you can also raise unlimited additional campaign cash. And so if an IE, let's say for only $10,000 or $20,000 comes into the race and then you get a waiver, it's a waiver for the spending cap. It's not like you can only respond with $10,000 or $20,000 and match the IE that's coming into the race. You can raise and spend unlimited amounts of campaign contributions. And just like the proponents have stated, the no side, no election vouchers, has also been endorsed by two former chairs of the Seattle Ethics and Elections Commission, because they are also concerned about the unintended consequences and the risks that this initiative brings along. And to go back to something that was brought up in the previous answer, or in the previous question actually, in these district elections, we are already seeing a huge flood of independent expenditure money. So to say that there won't be a huge push into IEs is false. We're already seeing it, and under this system, it'll continue and only get worse.
Thank you. Let me ask this next question, and you might be able to address what he just said too. Is this fully funded? So, for example, if everyone used their $25 vouchers, would candidates get those dollars associated with the vouchers given to them? So that's kind of a two-part question. Go ahead, okay. Pro.
So I went to law school. I do not have a degree in math, but we have done the math on this. $3 million a year, $6 million per election cycle, right? Because it's every other year. So the pool of money is $6 million a year, minus some administrative costs for printing vouchers, for hiring additional elections commission staff, and setting up the electronic system. Let's say that leaves you about $5.5 million. That money is more than enough to fund to the entire spending cap of 46 people running for city attorney. It is enough to fund 8 people running for mayor. It is an enormous amount of money to fit into those spending caps. In no circumstance under I-122 would it exceed that spending. And under that situation, let's say we have $5.5 million divided by 100, follow me on the math here, that's 55,000 people who are able to talk to a candidate and feel invested and connected with a candidate that they choose to support. How many people currently give money right now to Seattle candidates? 6,000. There's the same 6,000 people keep giving money over and over and over again. This would increase that by almost 10 times under I-122.
Thank you. Go ahead, Khan.
So the fact of the matter is that this initiative is not fully paid for. It raises property taxes. As I said before, there are 415,000 registered voters in the city of Seattle. If everyone gets $100 worth of vouchers, that's $41.5 million. This initiative only funds $6 million, and actually using the numbers from the proponents, they estimate that there will be $650,000 worth of administrative costs per year. That's $1.3 million in a cycle. So every cycle where there's $6 million spent, $1.3 million of that is for administration. And that's a conservative estimate from the proponents. So that leaves $4.7 million worth of vouchers. Divide that by $25 per voucher, that's $188,000. And eventually, you only get 47,000 voters who could potentially use their vouchers. So no, not every registered voter can use it. It's not fully paid for. I think you're gonna have one of two things happen. Either the system is gonna be a complete failure and no one's gonna use them, or it's gonna be an overwhelming success and only the people who turn them in early, who are part of well-funded, well-organized special interest groups, will be able to redeem them. There are going to be a lot of people who will turn them in to find out that they can't actually donate to the candidates of their choice because it's not paid for.
Thank you. We'll start with the pro side again. Has this type of voucher system been used in any other city or county or state? And if so, what effects have been seen?
So let me just make sure I address this point. There's a lot of numbers being thrown around. Let me say it again. This is a fully funded system because it is not limited by the number of voters. It is limited by the number of candidates, and it's limited by the candidate spending cap. We do not want to have $40 million worth of public money being used in our candidate campaigns. Can you imagine our mailboxes? How much stuff would be in them? How many ads would be on the airwaves? We don't want that. We want to limit campaign spending, and we want to incentivize candidates to speak directly to voters, and that is why there's a cap. If this is incredibly successful, like we think it will be, and if for some reason candidates come to us and say, I think I would be able to raise a lot more money from a lot more voters, then the SEC has the ability to raise those spending caps, if that's what they want to do. Okay, the question that's currently right here is, where has this been used before? So public financing has been very successful across the country and cities across the country. And Seattle and Maine are two places this year that are looking at different implementations of public financing models. Usually what happens is a candidate raises $100 and then public financing will match it 6-to-1 or 10-to-1. The complaint about that system has been voters don't have a choice about who gets the money, right? So this takes this and tweaks that by giving voters the choice about who gets the money. We get to choose who gets our public money by giving the candidates that we approve of, that connect with us, our vouchers.
Thank you.
So, while this initiative was being drafted, some of the proponents actually were working with some people on our team and having open discussions about the process and kind of various elements that they wanted included in this. And what's very interesting is while they were formulating this initiative, they found through their polling that the voucher system is deeply unpopular. And so they decided to look at a whole host of other issues. They threw in lobbying, revolving door, pay-to-play, campaign contribution limits, et cetera, and then put it all in a package, teamed it like an anti-corruption measure, a empowering people measure, and so it sounds really good. But when you actually break it down into its individual components, the core of it is really this voucher system, which has never been done anywhere else in the country. Seattle would be the first. And if it's successful here, then the plan is to run it statewide and then in other states. So I think this is very much more just part of their agenda to get this kind of campaign finance reform, and they're using Seattle as a kind of a testing ground. But I think at the core of it, what we've been talking about, which are the vouchers, are just the wrong approach for making our elections more fair, more honest, and better for people.
Thank you. And I think we'll just go ahead and go to your wrap-up or closing statements. So I think we started with the pro side, so let's go ahead and start with the con. Why don't you go ahead and take a minute to wrap up?
Sure. Well, first, I just wanted to say thank you for having me and for giving me the opportunity to present the con side to Initiative 122. The reason why I encourage you to vote no is everything we've talked about tonight. It actually is going to make special interests more powerful. It's going to push more money into independent expenditures, which are less transparent, less accountable. I actually used to work at Perkins Coie. I did campaign finance compliance while I was there. I handled million-dollar checks from George Soros and other, you know, wealthy billionaires to go into super PACs, and that's not right. Citizens United is an awful decision, and we need to work to overturn that so we can really transform our electoral system. But this is going to have a host of unintended consequences, and I think it's the wrong approach for Seattle and for the rest of the country, and we need to be focusing our efforts elsewhere to bring about real, meaningful campaign finance reform. So I encourage you to vote no, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Three things. First one is I-122 is very popular with Democrats. We've seen some polling, and I'm shocked that Matt has seen some previous polling that said that vouchers weren't popular. In fact, they're very popular with voters because they give voters the choice to engage with candidates and encourage candidates to engage with voters. The second one is, again, I want to remind you about all of the long list of organizations and wonderful people who have endorsed I-122, and that includes the Puget Sound Advocates for Retirees and Advocates for Retiree Action. That includes NARAL. We have One America Votes. Senator Pramila Jayapal is one of our endorsers. Speaker of the House Frank Chop. The list is very long. I encourage you to go on our website to see it. And the reason they endorse this is because we agree that big money has too much influence over our government, and this is a way to limit that and to empower ordinary people to have a voice. Now, our opponents have one strategy and one strategy only, and that is to confuse voters and tell you all of the ways that this could go wrong with unintended consequences. The truth is that this has been reviewed by many election law experts, is being supported nationally by groups like Public Citizen because they believe that this is a model that will work very well in Seattle, and you're right, possibly in other cities across the country. I encourage you to vote yes on I-122, and thank you so much for staying late to hear us.
Thank you. Give a big round of applause to our speakers. So that concludes our ballot issues forum for the evening, but if you'd kindly direct your attention to our president, Amanda Clark, for a few more minutes.
Thank you very much, Ellen, for the great job that you did moderating this. And I want to thank all the panelists who were here. I thought they did an excellent job of making their points. And after this last panel discussion, while you're thinking about campaign financing, our next forum, in fact, on October 1st, a Thursday, will be on campaign financing. Also, if you have other questions about both initiatives, your candidates, and things, I encourage you to look at vote411.org, which is the League's online voter's guide. So that, I think, wraps it all up. I hope you will have a good evening, and thanks again for everybody coming. And one little last announcement. Did anyone lose a key fob for a... And also, Joanna just reminded me, there is a school board candidates forum on what date? October 8th, and that will also be here in the Baptist Church. So thanks again.